It's 1348, and a pandemic is sweeping through the British Isles.
It's a brutal disease. It's indiscriminate. It kills about a third of the human population.
What do we do with all these bodies piling up? They're lying in the streets. It takes 2 to 3 days to die.
In some parts of the country, villages were abandoned. There are hundreds of villages whose existence we know about from documents which simply disappeared.
The bubonic plague we know today as the Black Death comes back in waves, killing over decades, terrorizing a people who still believe in a literal heaven and hell.
There is no way in the 14th century of interpreting the Great Plague other than as God's judgment. It has to mean that God has given us a reset.
The plague caused people to ask really profound questions about themselves, about religion, about society.
Out of the chaos comes disruptive art. Survivors finding their voice, questioning authority, challenging status and class.
Throughout history, insecurity has been a major creative force.
It inspires a desire to make new art, to speak to a world that looks fundamentally different.
You have some of the greatest poets, some of the greatest cathedrals built, some of the greatest stained glass windows, new ways of exploring life.
This is a moment for extraordinary female voices.
They're being heard in a way that we don't really hear again until the 19th century.
Everything is in the mix, and this urgent literature comes into full force and life.
This is a story of the great plague of the Middle Ages and its bitter but profoundly creative aftermath.
Brothers and sisters, a new day is coming. Now is the time.
This is just one chapter in an epic journey. Across 1,500 years, through 8 dramatic turning points of history, as contemporary artists and thinkers encounter artworks that defined their age.
Man, can he paint?
Exploring extraordinary creations from around the UK.
I mean, if you imagine trying to make that, how do you begin?
The work of past visionaries, mavericks and rule breakers, who responded to their times and shaped their future.
Got it, this is.
Extraordinary drawings. This was a reviled insect.
Tracing a story of creativity, revealing an alternative history of these islands told through art. Disease and death have ravaged the isles. One poet, writing in a northern dialect of medieval English, explores the kind of grief that would have been felt in a ghost story about a jeweler who has lost a precious pearl.
Pearl pleasant to princes pay, to clanly clothes in gold so clear. Ut vorient he hardly say, nay proved he never her precious pair. So ruined, so reckon in uchere, so small, so smooth her seed swear. Wheresoever he judged gems gay, he set her singly in singlore.
But I lost my pearl in a garden of herbs. She slipped from me through grass to ground, and I mourn now with a broken heart for that priceless pearl without a spot. I'm not sure that there is a more intricate and accomplished poem in the whole of English literature, before or afterwards? Well, the narrator in the poem tells us that he's lost his pearl. We realise after a while that he's talking about a child, and he goes back to the place where he says this pearl has slipped through his fingers. He falls asleep, and he enters a very deep dream in which the child comes back to him on the other side of a river. A noble girl, a young woman of grace, wearing a gown of iridescent white, and I knew her so well. I had seen her before. He's so taken with the idea that he can be with her again, tries to leap into the river and cross to her side, tries to cross to heaven, even though she said that, you know, he can't do that because he's not dead. And the cold water in the dream wakes him up on the riverbank and he's lost her all over again. I did get very choked up towards the end, possibly because I am the father of one daughter. If you imagine that you've lost something that is so meaningful to you, and you have a dream and it comes back, and then you wake up, you've lost this thing all over again.
It is the most natural thing in the world, isn't it, to want what you can't have? A sense of that longing to see someone who has gone. It's not easy to put voice to a loss. It's a stunningly beautiful poem. It's very highly worked over.
The poem is constructed, I always think, like a necklace. Each stanza is connected by a repeated phrase or word, and then on it threads through.
I fell upon that flurry flacht, such ordor to me ernest shut.
I slod upon a sleeping slacht on that precious pearl, withouten spot.
We're aware that what we're reading is this astonishing creation made by this jeweler of words. It's the most perfect tension of what it is to be really human and grieving, and then what it is to have this knowledge of eternity and divinity. It is a masterpiece.
I think the pearl poet is trying to negotiate between the known and the unknown. This poet is mischievous. He's definitely inquiring, questioning. He says at the end, you know, oh, well, you know, I can be consoled by my faith in God. I'm not sure that I absolutely believe that.
He hath been a joyless jeweler.
I live without joy, like a jeweler without jewel.
Death and disease are not the only forces spreading through the land. While the pearl poet puts words to grief, the plague shakes up the living and fuels anger towards the elites who have ruled England since 1066. Rebellious spirits are at work, even in unlikely places. In churches around the British Isles, carpenters carve elaborate satirical scenes under the misericords, the oak ledges on which clergy perch their backsides during hours of prayer. This is art from below, in all senses.
Can see here looks like some sort of monkey funeral. Oh, there's a poor little monkey there laying in the middle. Considering this was made in the years after the Black Death, I mean, this is extremely cheeky. I think it's poking fun at religion and ritual. I kind of love that they're doing it here.
this ledge under the seat would be carved with scenes which are entertaining, perhaps sometimes a little bit salacious.
It's a place for storytelling, for delight, for cheekiness, certainly. And yes, a little bit of pushback.
What's so lovely about the misericords is it shows really, satire is always the weapon of the weak. If you can't say boo to authority in public, you can make a carving that's concealed underneath the buttocks of a priest to make your point to those in the know.
Our woman, you see, now you're talking. So this one looks almost like a wife beating a husband, sort of subverting the male-female relationship. I can definitely relate to this. Maybe not the violence, but definitely the sentiment behind it. I really relate to that need to comment on the world around you and to do that in the cheekiest possible way. I realised at some point that I could use funny things to make a point about something quite serious. And I think there's like a relief in that, being able to laugh. But sometimes I'm like, when I'm putting it out into the world, what are people going to say? I've always been interested in Fisher's identity because I was brought up in like a mixed background. My mum's Muslim and my dad isn't. Such stereotypes about Muslim people, I just found that so frustrating. I wanted to fight back against that, blow people's expectations out of the water. This one is probably the most intricate one that I've seen so far. This is Knight falling off its horse, and just wow, the way that it captures the neck of the horse there and the just intricate details in the mane and here on the chain mail. This, you see the arrow going in, and yeah, it's just a real flow and movement in the carving, which is just incredible how it's being captured.
He's been shot carefully in the back. Well, that's a death by assassination. This is a warning to the ruling elite of England. There you are, up on your high horse, looking down on us, but you just watch your back, my lover.
I think for me, this one makes me kind of go, yeah, it's kind of seeing the fall of authority. We do like to almost build people up and then bring them down again.
By the time these misericords are being created, the plague has cut the British Isles population of around 7 million in half. In England, the shortage of workers gives peasants a new power to demand higher wages.
The political class tried to regulate wages so as to stop people asking more. This was as hopeless an endeavour in the 14th century as it was on the last occasion that we tried it in the 1970s.
The shape of the economy and the shape of the relationship between ruler and ruled is all in the mix.
The Black Death creates a modern wage economy. Suddenly, no one's quite sure of their place anymore. And it's that that leads to people thinking, inverted commas, above their station.
The growing anger around status and class is noticed by an ambitious civil servant. He's working on a book about a motley crew of pilgrims entertaining each other with stories. In the Canterbury Tales, Geoffrey Chaucer crafts a satire not in wood, but in words. One of his greatest creations is a widow on the make, inheriting wealth and status from a series of dead husbands.
If there were no authority on earth except experience, mine for what it's worth, and that's enough for me, all goes to show that marriage is a misery and a woe.
The wife of Bath is easily the most memorable character in the Canterbury Tales.
She's loud, she's large, she wears statement clothes.
My lords, since when I was but 12 years old, thanks be to God eternal evermore, five husbands have I had at the church door.
I've had five husbands, looking out for the sixth, has a look round, then says, anyway, here's what I did with my husbands. I nagged them to death.
Bedtime, above all, was their misfortune.
I shagged them to death.
In wifehood, I will use my instrument as freely as my maker me it sent.
I mocked them, I spent all their money.
I never would abide in bed with them when hands began to slide, till they had promised ransom, paid a fee, and then I let them do their nicety.
Anyway, it was fantastic. I had a brilliant time.
Chaucer is funny. He's a satirist. What he mocked most often was pretentiousness. Here was a lower middle class woman with ideas above her station.
She's shagged her way to the top by seeing off five husbands. Because of their inheritances, she's become rich, and she's trying to act like a noblewoman. And there's this wonderful comic example to them of something serious going on in society, and that's what the best comedy is always about.
There is so much to love about Chaucer. He is a kind of a poet for everyone. You have tales where there are people kissing people's bums, and there are, you know, sitcom kind of setups.
The other side of the wife is that she's a victim of a certain level of misogyny and abuse.
And many a blow he struck me still can ache along my row of ribs and will until my dying day.
She talks about the misogynistic literature that her fifth husband reads and drives her mad reading to her, which is all about the terrible women of the past, starting from Eve.
In rage, and I love her for this, she tears a leaf out of the book.
Then, like a maddened lion, with a yell, he started up and smote me on the head, and down I fell upon the floor for dead.
He hits her on the head, she gets deafened. This is a horrible story.
He came up close, and kneeling gently down, he said, my love, my dearest Alison, so help me God, I never again will hit you, love. And if I did, you asked for it. Forgive me. But for all he was so meek, I up at once and smote him on the cheek.
Chaucer is playing in different directions. He has you willing her on and supporting her and being very amused at all her victories. And yet, at the same time, you have to be horrified and realise that this is no kind of model for existence.
You can find light and shade in it. I love dark comedy, and the stuff I write is dark, but sometimes it's near the knuckle. And I think sometimes when we're at our lowest, we have to find that humour to get us through. And I think this monologue has that in it. It could go either way.
The Canterbury Tales has become one of the most famous works of world literature. But more widely read at the time is a radical utopian poem which lashes out at the failures of church and state in the wake of the plague.
I looked east towards the sun and saw a tower, as I guess. Truth was inside. I looked west a while after and saw a deep dale. Death, I believe, dwelt in that place, and wicked spirits. I found between them a fair field full of folk, of all manners of men, the poor and the rich, working and wandering, as this world asks. Piers Plowman tells a story of a character called Will, who falls asleep on the Malvern Hills and has an incredible vision of the world as a fair field full of folk. And he then goes on this kind of pilgrimage to try and find a character called Truth.
Tom adapted the poem in 2017 for a touring theatre production called Fair Field.
What kind of plot is this?
Hello?
Is anyone there?
I know this place. I remember it from a daydream.
A field.
A fair field full of...
Now. Pot pies!
Excuse me.
Pot pies. Chicken!
Excuse me.
Mushroom!
Where are we?
A chicken tikka slice!
I mean, what is this place called?
Can't you see, brother?
This is Cheapside! Cheapside in the great city of London!
I think Piers Plowman has been overlooked in the canon of English literature. It's messier, it's not as slick a production as the Canterbury Tales. But for me, Piers Plowman is more human. A poem that speaks to the working person from a working person.
On the positive side, we have our own place, our own slice of heaven. A fair field full of folk. I'm on my way there now.
Follow me.
To be quite honest, I find Langland's ideas extremely interesting. As a piece of writing, it leaves me cold.
Langland is doing something very daring. He's writing in English, writing for everyone, explicitly for everyone and about everyone.
Today, English has become a world language.
This is London calling. Here is the news read by Derek Chamley.
Yet in Langland's time, the common tongue of the most populous kingdom in the Isles is a poor relation to French, the language of the authorities, and Latin, used by the church. But things are changing.
One of the things that's hardest for us to imagine today is the idea of 14th century England as profoundly multilingual, where English, French, and Latin are constantly jockeying for place.
To just speak English meant you were, in England, a second-class citizen, and you knew it every day of your life. And that all changes with the Black Death.
It's a period in which Middle English is developing quite profoundly as a language of literature and poetry.
You only need one text and one person who can read in a village for that village to be literate. If you've got a copy of something and it makes it to your village, then one person can read it out in the pub or in the market square and everyone can hear it.
One of the things that's exciting about reading Langland is seeing someone who is testing the limits of that language to see what it can do.
Langland pitches Will into crazy escapades like a pub crawl with the seven deadly sins and encounters with a humble worker, Piers the Plowman, who is growing disillusioned by the corruption of the world.
Now is the time. Comrades, we must gather our tools. Fling open the gates with sickle and with scythe, with pitchfork and ploughshare.
Anger with the ruling elite boils over in 1381. The English government is imposing an unpopular poll tax. The Hundred Years' War has gone sour following French raids on England's southern coast.
The leaders of the rebellion sent letters to one another, and the figure Piers the Plowman is referenced in these letters. You know, Piers Plowman must come and do his work. Now is time for right to come, for corruption to be destroyed, for the evil to be brought down. Now is time.
Rich and poor, lord and peasant, these are just illusions. For when Adam delved and Eve span, who was then the gentle man?
The peasants revolt and loot London. Records and legal documents in French are burned. Lawyers are lynched. The Archbishop of Canterbury is killed, and the rebels parade his severed head through the streets.
Here you have these English rebels who are just targeting what they see absolutely as basically the metropolitan elite culture. They are sick of it.
The 14-year-old King, Richard II, has to ride out personally to persuade them to disband.
This is the first time that a King of England has spoken to the ordinary English in English since 1066. What a moment. And they just roll over. And that just changes the whole way he sees himself. He sees kingship for the rest of his life, fatally, as it turns out.
Richard now uses art to proclaim his divine right to rule. As a political revolution fails, an artistic one begins.
First impressions are very much of a religious icon. You know, all the props, the suggestion, the crosses, there's layers and layers of symbols and you know, all props going to reinforce this notion of him being a ruler by divine right. You know, you'd think that was God. All the portraits that I shoot, it's about taking the subject towards stillness. You know, at a point of stillness, there's a deeper truth that's revealed. When I first got the call, I thought it was a friend of mine pulling my leg. Been asked to do Indian gurus, rock stars, but the Queen just somehow seemed far-fetched.
Chris Levine was commissioned to record an ambitious holographic image of the Queen. And alongside it, he captured a chance snap that seemed to take us closer to the human being under the crown.
When the eyes are open, you engage with the eyes. The eyes close somehow, you go into a deeper, more expansive space, and there's a truthfulness somehow.
Chris's innovation follows a long tradition of royal portraiture that begins with that first painting of a living English king, Richard II. Life-size, painted on oak boards, with the kind of gilding and pigments that are also seen in East Anglian church painting, the picture is often attributed to Richard's court painter, Gilbert Prince.
There's something I find slightly creepy about this image and the eyes. You know, there's something almost a little bit Stalinesque about it.
It's not designed to convey a personality. It's designed to convey an image of authority. He is completely oblivious of our presence.
You know, the pose and the head-on, the directness of it, he looks as if he's looking right through you. It's as if you're being summoned to him somehow. When shooting the Queen, I wanted to do something that would represent a kind of evolutionary step forward. Like Richard here, Diana had her looking out beyond, past the camera and into the future. It's uncanny that, you know, you look at the portrait from different angles and he's following you. You know, and that's a trick, if you like, that's been used through the centuries. And, you know, this was a game changer. This is where it began.
Grandiose and authoritarian, Richard becomes isolated. In 1399, he's forced to abdicate by his nobles and less than a year later is starved to death. But among the possessions Richard leaves behind is another extraordinary artwork. And one that takes us to the core of his tragedy. The Wilton Diptych is a portable altar panel which imagines God standing literally by the king.
It shows Richard II as he was at the time of his coronation when he was a teenager, being presented by his three personal patron saints, St. Edmund, Edward the Confessor, and John the Baptist, to the Virgin, who is surrounded by angels.
If we imagine him stopping at some public place and opening this thing up, now that would have been seen, of course. And so when you saw the king worshipping this altar of himself, must have given you a real shiver up the spine as a watcher to think of this enactment of utter self-belief.
When curators at the National Gallery restored the painting, they discovered startling, previously hidden details that reveal the hubris at the heart of the picture.
There are so many things about it that are mysterious to us. We'd like to understand why it was made, why it looks the way it does. We don't know who painted it. Of course, you had the opportunity to look very closely, and you discovered some pretty extraordinary things.
I think it was probably one of the most exciting things that ever happened to me, being a curator here. In the orb, at the top of the flag, is a tiny white castle and a silver sea with a boat in full furl.
We assume, therefore, that that's the island of Britain. There seems to be some sort of transaction going on here. Christchild is handing the standard over to the young Richard II. And that's, in a way, one of the central elements of the picture, the relationship between the King of England, the Court of Heaven, and, of course, England itself.
It is so personal to Richard that it must have been painted in England, at the English court. The angels, they're all wearing Richard's emblem of the white heart. So they're not just angels in the Court of Heaven, they're Richard's supporters. The whole focus of this painting is really the king and not the Virgin Child.
You could see this almost as a kind of a medieval selfie, the sort of image that you might post on Facebook and say, look at me, I'm here with the heavenly company.
It's very beautiful and positive, and this kind of beautiful blue of lapis and the gold leaf, it's kind of literally otherworldly, isn't it? Or it's a connection between one world and the other. It appears pure, it's obviously not, it's tainted by politics and power. This is in fact propaganda, isn't it?
Artist Mark Quinn is drawn to art that comes out of chaos and illness, and the tensions pandemics spark between power and the people, all the way from the Black Death to COVID-19.
Social change comes when the top isn't listening to what's happening below, and at a certain point, that cracks. It's a period of anxiety, fear, all these different emotions. Everything's going a little bit crazy. It's like a kind of invisible war, in a sense.
In his series History Now, Quinn records his reaction to the toll of each day's news.
The painting materializes an image. So this idea that the world is changing and things are moving around, everything liquefies. And then when I throw the splashes on top of it, it's almost like the same paint exists as chaos.
Amid the chaos of the Middle Ages' great pandemic, come voices rarely heard before. In Norwich, the second largest city in medieval Britain, a woman we know today only as Julian devotes herself in the most extreme way to her faith and an extraordinary piece of writing.
An anchoress was a hermit-like figure, so you would essentially be kind of dead to the world, and then you would spend the rest of your life as a recluse in this cell attached to a church.
But for I am a woman. Should I therefore live, that I should not tell you the goodness of God? as we understand it. Her book is the first surviving book in English by a woman writer. Not only is the quality of the writing itself astonishing for any type of writer of any gender, her writing in this period, I would suggest, is a proto-feminist act. Women at this period are not allowed to ask questions. They're not allowed to preach. They're encouraged to be in silence.
But Julian speaks her mind through mystical visions. Age 30 and near death from a mysterious illness that may have been the plague, Julian has a fever dream in which she experiences 16 showings, as she calls them.
I suppose we could think about them in terms of how she describes them, almost as being psychedelic. And in this, he showed me a little thing, the quantity of a hazelnut, lying in the palm of my hand as it seemed. And it was as round as any ball. I looked upon it with the eye of my understanding and thought, what may this be?
How do I understand this thing, this nut?
She looks at it and asks God what it is, and he says, it is all that is made.
It's the world and God surrounds it.
You know when the camera dives into something and it expands to a universe, it's like that. And she looks at this thing on her hand and she thinks, how does it survive?
And I was answered in my understanding. It lasts and ever shall, for God loves it. There's been massive suffering and death and a generalized perception of God as being vengeful, of populations as being decimated and punished for sin. Julian doesn't see it this way. All should be well, and all should be well, and all manner of things should be well. She continues to believe and continues to spend time excavating this sense of God as being loving. God loved us before he made us, and his love has never diminished and never shall.
The movement towards a more personal style of worship was one of the great mental changes of the period. These were the classic symptoms of a world looking for a more direct relationship with God than the church with its hierarchy could ever have provided.
Just a few years before she dies, Julian has a visitor, another woman, but a very different character. She's troubled and seeking advice.
Margery Kempe is from East Anglia. She's from King's Lynn. Her father was the mayor of Lynn. So she's from this kind of growing middle class, shall we say, in English society.
Margery has had fits and visions ever since the birth of her first child, possibly suffering from what we now recognise as postnatal depression.
On a night, as this creature lay in bed with her husband, she heard a sound of melody so sweet and delectable that she thought she had been in paradise. And therewith she started out of her bed and said, "Alas, that ever I did sin. It is full merry in heaven."
She undergoes a spiritual conversion, and that's the point at which her book begins.
Margery's book is the first autobiography written in English, a tell-all account of pilgrimages to shrines around Britain and beyond, and the many scrapes that the creature, as she calls herself, has with religious authorities.
Everywhere she went, she would be struck with the sensation, the horror, the sorrow of Christ's passion. And she would find it impossible not to fall on the ground, pound the earth. And people did not know what to make of her.
And she wept astonishingly.
she wished to come on, could not keep it quiet.
Her travelling companions found her excitable and tiresome, and indeed there is one point in her book where she says that they wished that she were put to sea in a boat with a large hole in it.
She goes into a church and sees an image of Christ's sufferings.
And she is overwhelmed with grief.
And the parish priest basically says to her, look, Margery, Christ died a long time ago. It's almost like he's sort of saying, get over it, Margery.
When her crying ceased, she said to the priest, sir, his death is as fresh to me as if he had died this same day. And so I think it ought to be to you and to all Christian people.
She came before the archbishop and fell down on her knees, the archbishop saying full boisterously unto her,
woman, why do you weep so? She, answering, said, sir, you shall wish some day that you had wept as hard as I.
And right there we can see everything about Margery's relation with authority.
The 15th century world Margery Kemp travels through is increasingly prosperous. The plague has left behind fewer people, but with higher wages and more goods to go round. In Wales, an imposing artwork warns the population about the temptations of the new consumer economy.
Oh, wow. It's impressive. So, first thing I see is what looks like St. George with his English flag, which is quite odd to see in a Welsh church. That generally wouldn't go down very well these days.
The St. Cadoc's Church murals are some of the most vivid in the British Isles, but they were only rediscovered in 2007 following a roof renovation, concealed under 20 layers of lime wash slapped on since the Reformation.
And then what looks like the seven deadly sins. Got these demons and this monster of doom, which seems to be devouring the sinners. I really like how stylized it is. A lot of the details in all of the sins. Then you've also got this stenciled pattern in the background, almost like a wallpaper. It's just a bit of a trick of the trade, really, using patterns and simple kind of effects to cover a large space while keeping the focus in one place.
For Welsh street artist Bryce Davis, Cardiff is a canvas.
Throughout the ages, there's always been large-scale murals painted, and I'm part of that legacy that started with the caveman drawing on walls through to the church and the murals of the Black Death, straight through to today. We do the same thing. We paint the murals and try to convey a message through to the public.
The most remarkable message at St. Cadoc's, faint now but still eerily powerful, reveals how memories of the plague still haunted the medieval mind.
So I see what looks like a well-dressed gentleman, and then on the other side here, it kind of looks like a bride, but I'm assuming that's death. A kind of skeleton in a cloak, taking him by the hand. Perhaps it's death kind of leading him away, telling him his time's up.
An image about the futility of earthly riches. We can't take those with us beyond the grave. It relates to a motif that was popular at the time, particularly in Northern Europe. It's the dance of death, or the dance macabre. Young people, children, old people, dancing alongside figures of death. It's a motif that, in a sense, brings levity to something that is very profound and difficult.
During this time, life expectancy was pretty low. I imagine most people probably didn't live a great deal past 30. It's a real strong kind of sense of maybe using your life, living your life to the fullest.
The despair and anger of the plague years are replaced through the 15th century by a new sense of purpose and industry. Grabbing life chances while they can, many peasants leave the fields and migrate to towns and cities. Here, they learn new skills, join craft guilds, and seek their fortune.
There's a kind of buzz, right? There is opportunity around. Artistry and craft is something that is being recognized and rewarded.
We suddenly start getting names of artists, of other creators, writers.
They're really attractive to the nobility who offer patronage and employment, instead of the craft itself being valued in an anonymous way. The authors were increasingly valued.
Artisans crisscross the land, refurbishing and extending churches with a new look. The template is Gloucester Cathedral. Its airy choir and transepts inspire a distinctive architectural style.
It's known as perpendicular. Thinner walls with huge windows, a style in which churches were flooded with light.
The style of church building moves very quickly into this flight into the air. The windows, the vaulting, the buttresses. I'm doing this with my arms because that's what happens. Your eyes and your whole body is oriented to the heavens.
It's not all original. Some features are borrowed.
The Gothic arch is a design that's first seen in the Ibn Tulun Mosque in Cairo. Ribbed vaultings is something that we see in mosques in Toledo, in Cordoba. These are ideas that came into Western Europe through pilgrims, through crusaders, Muslim craftsmen.
The impact on people entering them, who lived essentially still in glorified mud huts, most of them, to walk into one of these palaces of light pointing straight up at heaven, must have just been extraordinary.
At York Minster, the rebuild creates space for a different type of medieval masterpiece. Over 23 meters high, the size of a tennis court, the Great East Window is Britain's biggest expanse of stained glass.
It looks just like a great, colorful, sparkling cliff of glass. Although the window was made in the early years of the 15th century, it was really part of the regeneration of the city and the church in the aftermath of the plague. They had this enormous ambition for this great lantern lighting the whole of the eastern arm of the Minster.
There is no picture that doesn't tell a story. We've been told that we're supposed to be a people of the book, we're not great visual artists. That's a Reformation story, because, of course, the Reformation deliberately destroyed these things. In fact, in pre-Reformation England, it's just a fiesta of visual art.
It effectively represents all of time and all of history. Events from the Old Testament, representations of saints and kings. And then we end up at the end of time with the apocalypse.
As we move in closer, we find incredible detail. In its ambition, can be compared to something like the Sistine Chapel in Italy.
Glazier John Thornton is paid £56 as lead artist to cartoon the overall story, but also bring detail and style to each panel.
People now talk of the Thornton style. These very rough-hewn faces, you know, there's lots of curly hair, very rugged features. Some of the figures look as if he's, you know, gone out and done some sketching in the streets of York. He really conveys a sense of the psychological inner life of some of the people depicted in this window.
Here we have Adam and Eve being expelled from the Garden of Eden. The tree of knowledge that they've just taken the fruit from is behind them. Adam is still holding on to one of the fruits, but they look kind of glum about this. The eyes are downcast, and then there they have their fig leaves covering their shame.
It has humour. It has a fondness for the real world and real people. The fall of Babylon is represented by the sort of gentle tumbling of a few stones from the city wall. It's almost as if John Thornton couldn't quite bring himself to show urban life completely destroyed.
Great medieval artwork like this is a bit like a sort of modern film. You have a director, you have a producer, but then you also have lots of other people involved in the making of it. If you had the sort of credit lines rolling for the Great East Window, it'd probably come to quite a number of people. Stained glass is a very hands-on process, and as a result, we sometimes have details like even fingerprints or thumbprints left as a residue.
To find something like a fingerprint or a thumbprint, it really connects you to the fact that these have not just arrived fully formed, they were actually made by people hundreds of years before who were just as clever and sometimes just as careless as we can all be.
Imagine these soaring vaults filled with a new sound. While Thornton and his workers complete the Great East Window, one of the earliest named English composers experiments with a change in musical style. John Dunstable's motet is performed at Canterbury Cathedral in 1416 to commemorate Henry V's victory against the French a year earlier at the Battle of Agincourt.
That's it, yeah. So it's just making sure, Ben, that you catch Ed in 27 on that last crotchet, because he's just getting away from you just a little bit there. So let's just do that from somewhere like...
Veni Sancte is really remarkable. What he does is he has two different kind of structural parts. The two lowest voices are holding and singing two different kind of long note melodies. And then the two upper voices are decorating on top of that. And suddenly the sound is absolutely transformed.
For me, this is the most magical of pieces of music. The counterpoint between the voices is just so beautiful. And all the way through then, this sweetness just keeps coming in sort of waves. this is the piece I want at my funeral. This is the piece that creates that pause, that stillness.
I find the music of late medieval England, of composers like John Dunstable, very moving. Not everybody will agree, but when one remembers a very difficult period in which they were written, the sudden appearance of these exceptionally beautiful sounds is a very powerful experience.
Veni Sancte Spiritus, this veni is an invocation. It means come, come to us. So it's asking for the Holy Spirit to come and offer us protection against hell and purgatory and relief from our daily lives. And of course, we can relate to that nowadays as much as those who were listening to it all the way back in the 15th century can, I think.
Dunstable's reputation can be compared to the music of the Beatles in that he was famous, he had a cult following, he was known across Europe.
You could argue that Dunstable really is the beginning of the Renaissance, actually, rather than being a medieval composer. His music should be a real source of national pride because he introduced this new style to the continent, and so often the traffic is in the other direction. He's responsible, really, for shaping the history of music for the next 100 years or so.
John Dunstable's emergence is part of a deeper change as people recover from the trauma of the Great Plague. A new generation is breaking free of the past in the precious years given to them. As Chaucer put it, the life so short, the craft so long to learn.
It's the rebirth of our culture, frankly, and appears to be driven from the bottom up. It's driven by practical craftsmen and practical musicians, people who are sort of trained in a craft.
If you are lucky enough to survive, then you grab the opportunities that you have. It's a time of intense creativity.
Art is comforting, it is entertaining, but above all, it is the work of being human. And carrying on with life, constantly thinking, how could I be doing this better? and that's all there is, right?
Next time, a religious revolution brings faith and fire, feuding queens, and a golden age of theatre. When did you last subvert the status quo? Be inspired by some of the incredible but overlooked individuals who disrupted history with their creativity. Go to bbc.co.uk/art that made us and follow the links to the Open University.